faculty development program. Now today with us Dr. Subho Upadhyay sir for delivering the expert talk on the assessment of bioenergy resources. Sir is currently working as an assistant professor in Department of Electrical Engineering, Dayal Bagh Institute, Educational Institute, Agra, India. Sir has completed his PhD from IIT Roorkee in 2017. His research area include the integrated renewable energy system, power quality, power electronics application in renewable energy, artificial intelligence and its optimization. Sir has presently working on the project automatic solar module cleaning system funded by the Technical Education Quality Improvement Program, TQIP. Sir has published the number of research papers in various journals and conferences. Sir is also a reviewer of the various international journals and the conference, including the Elsevier, Springer and IIT. He is also working as an NSS program officer in his institute. So once again, I welcome to the Subho Upadhyay sir for the today's expert talk in the assessment of the bioenergy resources. So welcome you sir once again, and I hand over the session to the Upadhyay sir.
Thank you sir for such a nice introduction. I'm really thankful to you, as well as I like to thank the GEC, that is Government Engineering College Palanpur, for organizing such a wonderful lecture and series of lectures on the base topic, that is assessment and utilization of renewable energy resources, funded by ATAL, that is the government organization, government body that is sponsoring the series of lectures. And I also like to thank the participants who are such nicely participating and observing the lectures and giving their feedbacks, as well as interacting with the experts. I also like to thank the coordinator of the FDP, that is Dr. Alpesh Patel, for inviting me to deliver the talk. So I am sharing the screen. I think it is visible.
Not now, sir.
I think it is visible now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
And one more important thing is that, sir, this session is open for interaction. Even participants are allowed to mute their mic. Okay. You can interact in between the with the participant.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I think it is clear. The slide is clear, and I am also visible and audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So we will start the session by discussing about the topic, which is assessment of bioenergy resources. So assessment of bioenergy resources, and with the help of assessment, we will also figure out how the different type of application can we meet using these assessment of bioenergy resources. The table of content, the content that will be covered during this discussion will be, what is bioresource? So we will figure out what is the definition of bioresource and how these bioresources, different type of bioresources, can be converted into different outputs. So these, one of the important output from this bioresource is bioenergy. So we will figure out, we will focus into this important point, that is bioenergy here and its output. Then we will discuss about the biomass conversion techniques. So what are the different types of biomass conversion techniques that we will discuss, and what is the role of biomass conversion technique? Biomass conversion technique actually converts the bioresource / biomass into bioenergy. So So we will focus into some biomass conversion techniques, and there are basically three types of biomass conversion techniques, which are basically the biochemical conversion technique, that is the biodigester or anaerobic digestion, as well as we will focus into our topic about bioethanol from fermentation. Then the second important, so it is the basic way here what is happening, biochemical conversion technique. So what is a biochemical conversion technique? It is basically a way of interaction of biomass with the bacteria or yeast, and with this interaction and due to this, the chemical reaction will biogas for multiple applications that we will cover in this topic. Then we'll focus our object, our topic, that is physiochemical conversion technique. Physio means we have to do some experiments on certain bio, on certain oils. These oils can be oil seeds or different type of biomass will be there, and these biomass can be converted into certain output oils, utilizable oils, that is basically biodiesel. So we will discuss about the physiochemical, that is the experimental way of converting the biomass into some useful products. Then we will discuss about the thermochemical conversion process techniques. Thermochemical means we have to apply heat in the biomass, and with the help of heat, it will be converted into certain outputs or products for further utility. The basic points that we will discuss are biogasifiers and waste to energy plants. And finally, we will look into a case study, that is assessment of bioresources for electricity supply. So let us look into this important point, which is bioresource. So what is a bioresource? A bioresource are non-fossil biogenic resources. These are non-fossil because these are directly utilized. So it is the non-fossil biogenic resources which can be used by humans for multiple purposes. So what are the purposes? Basically to produce food and substantial products, such as woody biomass can be converted into furnitures, pulp in paper and pulp industries. So these are substantial products which can be derived from the bioresources, and or energy carriers. So energy carriers or the bioenergy part that we will be discussing. Sorry. So the major chunk of the bioresource is used for the production of food. If we talk about the bioenergy, so bioenergy is a type of renewable resource, renewable energy, that is derived from recently living organic materials. Now the bioenergy is basically consisting of biomass which is derived very recently from the dead organisms, from the dead plants, which can be used to produce transportation fuels, heat, electricity, and other essential products. Sorry. So basically, we can see from this diagram, we can look into it. A petrol station is there. In the petrol station, there are n number of, there is a petrol pump. In a petrol pump, there is also some biomass which is shown here. Now, what is happening here? The petroleum product can be mixed with the biomass. It can be utilized as a fuel for operating the cars or vehicles. Sorry. 1 minute, please. Don't mind. Am I visible now? Am I visible? Yes?
No, sir.
Yes, okay. Thank you. So we can see from this diagram, it should be visible that there is a petrol station or petroleum station is there. In the petroleum station, what is happening? The petroleum products is available along with the biomass. Now, what is the use of this bioenergy? This bioenergy is basically the recently living organic matters which is available, which can be plant products or animal products. This can be used into transportation of fuel, for transportation of vehicles, and this as a fuel. It can also be used as in the form of heat, electricity, and other essential products. Here we can see a power plant like of thing is here. So what is, how it can be used? We can see fossil fuels can be used for thermal power electricity generation. It can be mixed with biomass and we can get some energy from it. So how it is happening? Basically, the plant is trapping the sunlight, and with the help of photosynthesis, food is being generated, which is nothing but the biomass, and its use in multiple applications. So we have understood what is a bioenergy. It is the living organic materials, recently living organic materials. Now, how this bioenergy can be, we can obtain this bioenergy. So some of the biomass conversion processes are there. Thermochemical process, which involves thermal energy. Biochemical process use bioenergy, that is yeast or bacteria. And finally, there is a physiochemical energy, which is used here. Now, if we look into this thermochemical conversion, here is a gasifier. There will be a gasifier. And in a gasifier, there are multiple reactions are taking place. With the help of heat energy, it is performing different chemical operations, reactions. So there are multiple zones that are happening there. Where the oxygen part is very high, it will be oxidation that is going on or combustion. Gasification is the stage where both the oxidation and reduction will take place. And pyrolysis is the area or zone of the gasifier where reduction process will take place, that is in absence of oxygen. Now from these reactions, we will get certain different type of composition of gases. And these gases can be used for electricity, for heat, as well as the hydrogen, which is an important part of the gas, of the biomass, can be used in the fuel cell, and fuel cell can supply the electricity. And the residue portion is basically charcoal or tar particle that is available at the bottom of the gasifier that can be used for certain applications. If we talk about the biochemical conversion, there is a digester or anaerobic digestion takes place. In anaerobic digestion, the output will be biogas consisting of major portion as methane. And this can be used directly in the cooking purposes, as well as some portion can be used for driving the turbine and producing the electricity. Similarly, there is a fermentation also. So fermentation can also be considered as a biochemical conversion. Here, the sugar or starch can be converted into ethanol using distillation process. That ethanol can be used for driving different vehicles. Now similarly, so basically the ethanol is the alternative of petrol, but we cannot replace 100% of petrol. we can convert nearly 10% of the petrol with the ethanol. So blending will be there, and so the cost of petrol can be reduced. Then there is a extraction way. So extraction is basically the oil seeds are present. These oil seeds are basically taken from different plants. These can be jatropha, pongamia, or different type of vegetable oils. And with the help of esterification, we can convert this biodiesel, we can convert this edible or non-edible oils into biodiesel. Again, biodiesel is around only 10% of the overall diesel quantity. We cannot replace 100%. So biodiesel can also, by mixing the biodiesel with diesel, the quality of the diesel will not be reduced, but we can say its cost can be reduced if we use biodiesel as a fuel. So these are the important processes which are involved for obtaining fuel, electricity or heat, different type of applications from the biomass. Now let us discuss these topics one by one. The biochemical conversion process first. What is a biochemical conversion process? In a biochemical conversion process, we will discuss about the anaerobic digestion and the fermentation processes. Firstly, let us discuss about the anaerobic digestion first. In an anaerobic digestion, there will be a digester. In a digester, the manure, the biomass of a particular size will be fed to the digester. And after few days or certain amount of days, the amount of biomass will be get converted into manure and biogas, and that can be utilized for cooking as well as electricity supply. If we discuss about the fermentation part, then the sugar can be converted into ethanol with the help of distillation method, and yeast will be added to the sugar so that it can be converted. Now, if we talk about the biodigester at the beginning, we can discuss it as daily feed system. So it is a daily feed system, that is a continuous supply that we have to give to the plant, anaerobic digestion. The animal waste, if you have any doubts, you can also ask during the presentation. So daily feed system will be there. In a daily feed system, the animal waste can be directly fed into the anaerobic digester. Now, around 80% of this animal waste is basically the moisture content, and 20% is solid. Now it will take around 30 to 55 days to convert the first lot into biogas. Roughly around 30 to 55 days it will take. So some of the ways to convert this material into biogas is using some biogas plants. So some plants are there who use animal waste as the input. Now this animal waste can be converted into biogas using KVIC, that is Khadi and Village Industries Commission of Government of India, that is floating drum type model. So it is a floating drum type model, which is also known as KVIC plant. It can be operated for obtaining the biogas. Similarly, Janta model or Dinbandhu model is there for, it is another type of anaerobic digestion. If we talk about the kitchen waste, and kitchen waste can also be converted into biogas using Syntex, Kiloskar, Biotech, Aarti, etc. There are different type of companies, private companies, who can install the biogas plant comprising of kitchen waste into biogas. let us look into these biogas plants one by one. So the KVIC model biogas plant, this is a biogas plant which is shown here. This is a floating gas holder type. The dung is being mixed here in the mixing tank, and it will be flowed with the help of inlet pipe into the digester. This after around 30 days, there will be biogas that will be generated here and collected from the gas outlet pipe. If we look into this slurry part is basically the biodigester part, and from this we can, with the help of outlet pipe, we can collect the manure, and this manure can be used for increasing the fertility of the soil. The advantage is that there is a gas holder type system. So what is the advantage here? When the amount of gas increases, it will flow at a higher value. This holder type system will be lifted. When the gas is less, it will be at the lower level. Sorry. So I think it is clear. Similarly, if we look into the Janta model, so it is the primitive model. It is the older version of the above model. So again, here there is a mixing tank, and the output is fed into the digester, and there the bacteria will degrade the biomass, and we can get the biogas from the outlet, which is nothing but the maximum portion is methane here and CO2. And the outlet, we will get the manure. And there is a Dinabandhu model, which is the upgraded model of this Janta model. It is an upgraded model. So what is a biogas? So biogas is basically a product of anaerobic digestion. So it is basically the product of anaerobic digestion of organic waste or materials. That is basically animal waste, crop or crop residue, or kitchen waste that we had discussed. Now, what are the applications? It is suitable for cooking, lighting, and electricity generation. As well as, what are the other advantages? It has a fertilizer value. That is, it can be used as a manure to supply into the farms. Another important point that needs to be discussed is, it is safe. If we let the biomass or the cattle dung to be left aside, what will happen? A large quantity of methane will be emitted to the environment. It will become a hazard. So for safe utilization of this biogas, we can feed the biomass of the cattle dung into the anaerobic digester so that it can be safe. Aesthetic means it is beautiful. It is better. Rather than keeping the dung at the outside, it is better to feed into the digester. Then it has an economic value. We can get cooking gas from it. And waste is also converted into a manure. If we talk about the composition of biogas, around methane is comprising around 50 to 65% of methane. CO2 is around 30 to 40%. This is the major chunk. A small portion is hydrogen, nitrogen, hydrogen sulfide, oxygen, and water vapor. So this is the basic applications of the available biogas digester. If we look into this figure clearly, what we can see? There is a feeding operation at the top. In the feeding operation, the cattle dung or the kitchen waste or any crop residue can be fed, depending on the type of digester we are designing. What is a silage clamp? Silage is basically the biomass which is available can be stored so that its energy content is not reduced. So using some fermentation method, we can store the biomass available into certain useful form. Now this useful biomass can also be fed into the digester. The primary digester is known as fermenter, which we had discussed now. In that primary digester, we can also add the animal waste or manure storage. After fermentation, that is biogas that is obtained, biogas can be further supplied to the second digester, that is liquid digester and biogas storage. So in this storage tank, we will store the biogas for future applications. Now the post digester that is shown here consists comprising of basically the manure part or the outlet portion that had been shown there. That is the manure part. This manure can be differentiated into liquid and solid separation. So solid can be used as a for increasing the fertility, nutrient rich solid biomass can be supplied to the farms. The gaseous content can again be converted, means we can increase the energy content of this biogas by removing the water content, that is water vapor. Now by removing the water vapor, there is also some foul smell that we can find. So how to remove that foul smell? We can use the scrubbers. So H2S scrubber is there. So with that, we can remove the hydrogen sulfide portion of the gas which is available in the biogas part. So this supplies the foul smell, so we don't require that. Again, CO2 is also important because we have looked into that CO2 is around 30%. So removing of CO2 is also important. So if we remove the CO2 or we can capture the CO2, it can be better for the environment. Now, after removing the CO2 and H2S, that gas is basically the methane or biomethane, for simplicity we can say. This biomethane can be supplied to the grid for cooking purposes. Again, this biogas which is collected here can also be used for electricity generation, and this can be supplied to the grid also, exported to the grid also. That is important part. As well as this can also use for supplying heat to the localities where cold climate is there. Now let us talk about another important procedure, that is bioethanol. If we discuss about the bioethanol, so how the ethanol extraction process is there. So we will discuss the ethanol extraction process. So before that, we can look into what are the different sources from which ethanol can be extracted. So there are basically three major groups which are involved here. First group is sugar-based feedstock. So what are the sugar-based feedstock? These are sugarcane, beet sugar, sorghum, and other fruits. So with the help of these resources, this is basically known as sugar-based feedstock. Similarly, if we discuss about the starchy feedstock, so these are basically corn, sweet potato, rice, potatoes, cassava, wheat, and barley. So these are some of the examples. There are multiple number of examples are there. So then there is a lignocellulosic foodstock. Example, wood, straw, and grasses. Basically, these are the different types of feedstock which can be converted into ethanol that can be used for as a slight substitute of or mixing. We can mix this ethanol with the petrol, we can say. We'll discuss about the sugar-based feedstock first only. So how the sugar-based feedstock can be converted into ethanol? Initially, there is a milling process. So what is a milling process? It is basically a hammer which make a fine powder of the available sugar-based feedstock. Firstly, we have to make a small egg, a powder, a fine powder. Then there is a sterilization. Sterilization is basically to remove the biological contamination at the of the powder. In a powder, in the fine powder, there will be biological contamination which can be happen. So we have to remove that using sterilization. Then we have to apply the cooking. So how cooking will be there? The powder will be mixed with alpha amylase, which is an enzyme, and water. We have to boil it for 30 minutes. A mass will be generated. This mass can be needs to be cooled down. After cooking, we have to cool it down. Then we have to add secondary enzyme, that is glucoamylase. And with the help of glucoamylase, we can convert it into liquefied mass for that is the fermentable sugar. It is okay? Okay, thank you. So there is a fermentable sugar, that is dextrose, which is there. Now after cooling, we have to add the yeast. Whenever we are adding the yeast into this solution, it will be known as fermentation. So in the when the yeast is being added, the mass is converted into ethanol. Sugar to ethanol, that is being converted. And we will get carbon dioxide. Now the mass ferments, this mass which is available here, we have to leave it for 2 days so that sugar is converted into ethanol, alcohol. Now the then after getting the alcohol, this is not totally alcohol. This is not totally alcohol. There is a only 10% of this available fermented mass is alcohol. The remaining is non-fermentable solid. So we have to remove these non-fermentable solid so is to get better utilization. This is basically the beer, we can say. So for this, we have to perform the first stage distillation. So in the first stage distillation, distillation is basically the process when we heat a substance slightly above the boiling point so that we can convert the fuel or anything into gaseous form that can be stored in certain columns or certain storage can be there. So we have to perform the distillation process. Then we have to heat the alcohol slightly above the boiling point of the ethanol or alcohol that is obtained here. And this can be stored in a column. Now also, now we can say the amount, the percentage which is available, the alcohol percentage is around 60%, 50% that is available now after this distillation, first stage distillation is there. So we can see the vaporized alcohol is around 50%. The remaining is consisting of the remaining portion which is not needed. So what is 50%? So 50% is around 100 proof. 50% is 100 proof alcohol. So again, for increasing the concentration further, we have to perform the second distillation. Again, we have to heat this, we have to apply the same process that is reaching the above, slightly above the boiling point of the alcohol and converting that and storing that into some column. So after second distillation, around 95% will be available. Around 95% of the total available alcohol is 95% alcohol. The remaining 5% is water content. 95% equal to 190 proof, that is nothing but 95 into 2, that is 190 proof. Proof is a measure of ethanol content. 1% ethanol content equals 2 proofs. Now this remaining 5% of water is also not required, because we want to free this alcohol from the remaining portion. So we have to perform the dehydration. So for that, we have to add benzene and petrol in this dehydration, means water content is there, so we have to remove it. Hence, we have to apply benzene and petrol into this available alcohol. So with this, around 100% or 200 proof alcohol can be available. And again, we can see that this is not, cannot be used for drinking purposes. The available benzene and petrol, which the available alcohol which is available here, should be harmful for the people so that they cannot take this alcohol directly. So for that, denaturing is being applied. So what is denaturing? Denaturing is the process where around 2 to 5% of the petroleum product or petrol is being added. Means we can say 2 to 5% petrol is again added so that it becomes unfit for human consumption. Finally, this available fuel can be supplied to the gasol market where it can be blended with 90% of petrol and 10% ethanol. So this is one of the ways of converting this energy. Now, if we talk about another technique, that is physicochemical conversion technique. In a physicochemical conversion technique, we'll discuss about the extraction of biodiesel. So how extraction of biodiesel takes place? It is basically the oil seeds, all oil seed grains and plant fruits, which are the main sources. These can also be considering, we can also consider vegetable oils, petroleum oils or animal fats. Now there are two types of oil which is available, edible oil and non-edible oil. Edible oil is useful for human consumption. We can use edible oils for our food intake. But non-edible oil is only used for industrial application. Some of the non-edible oils cannot be used by human. So non-edible oils can be used for industrial purposes in case of fuel and biofuel production or in producing soap, detergent and paints, etc. Let us discuss about some non-edible oilseed feedstock for biodiesel. We can discuss about these are the different type of plants which can be used for biodiesel production. One is Pongamia, Neem, Jatropha, Cimarroba and Mahua. From these seeds can be powdered and these seeds can be filtered further. The oil can be filtered further for its utilization as biodiesel. So in between it, there is an esterification method that we had discussed in the beginning. So what is a esterification or transesterification process? It is a process by which the fatty acid or the vegetable oil that is available will be converted into a biodiesel. So it is a process of converting the fatty acid or vegetable oil into biodiesel. So in between it, there is a methanol which is being applied to the fatty acid or vegetable oil, and there will be in presence of catalyst will be there. So what is the catalyst here? There is a sodium or potassium methanolate, that is the catalyst, and we will get the mixture of fatty esters. This fatty ester is nothing but the biodiesel. So what is the advantage of reacting this with the methanol? We can see there is a chain, that is CH2, CH, CH2. This chain, if it is very large, it will increase the viscosity. So we have to reduce the viscosity so that it can be used for the biodiesel application. So to reduce this chain, we have to apply with a methanol. So methanol is treated with this triglyceride in presence of catalyst. So we will get the fatty ester and glycerol. Now this fatty ester is nothing but FAME, that is fatty acid methyl ester in this case, biodiesel, that is nothing but the biodiesel. So there, this composition can change depending on the type of edible oil or non-edible oil that is being applied. Now we can say there are two types of products which are available here. Glycerol. So glycerol can be used in the cosmetic industries and food industries as a chemical. And again, we can also use this fatty ester as a biodiesel. So we can blend it with diesel so that the overall diesel price can be reduced without affecting the quality and efficiency of the diesel as a fuel. So we can say the important products that can be extracted are physical characteristics of fatty acid esters are very close to those of fossil diesel fuels. The high viscosity that pure vegetable oils display is reduced by transesterification process. So the biodiesel which is obtained here is a non-toxic and biodegradable. It is very important. The product which is obtained from these reactions should be non-toxic, should be useful for the local people for various applications. So some of the properties of, since this biodiesel which is obtained here cannot be directly added to the biodiesel, so we have to apply certain processes. This biodiesel cannot be directly mixed into the diesel directly. We have to add certain other products that can be discussed. So if we talk about the third important process, that is thermochemical conversion process. In a thermochemical conversion process, before looking into the gasifier and waste to energy plant, we have to convert the biomass into particular form. So how to convert this biomass into particular form so that it can be utilized by the thermochemical conversion process, that is gasifier or waste to energy. So that we have to apply the pre-treatment techniques. So in the pre-treatment technique, aliasing is the first technique. So aliasing is the process of creating silage via anaerobic fermentation. So with the help of anaerobic fermentation, anaerobic means absence of oxygen, we have to fermentate this silage. Silage is basically the biomass which we have to store for further future applications. So for storing it, we have to supply this silage into the anaerobic fermenter so that it can be stored for a certain period of time, which is nothing but the aliasing, ensiling. So again, there will be a drying. So after, whenever we are trying to use this biomass, that is silage, we cannot directly use it. We have to remove the moisture content. So by removing the moisture content, we can increase the energy content of the fuel. So that we have to perform the drying operation. Then after drying, we have to perform the pelletization. So what is pelletization? It is a cylindrical shape. It is cylindrical shape biomass which can be used for gasifier. Now, how this pelletization will work? It is basically the drying and pressing of biomass under very high pressure. So we have to apply very high pressure so that this biomass can be converted into some chunks. See, these chunks will be of cylindrical size pieces that will be created. So we have to convert some pellets, the particular form that we have to press the biomass into cylindrical shape. And this cylindrical shaped biomass can be used for future application that we will discuss now. Then there is a torrefaction. So what is torrefaction? It is a thermal pre-treatment technology. So it is another pre-treatment technology. So here what will happen? The biomass which is available in the cylindrical pieces in case of pelletization will be heated at a temperature of around 200 to 300 degrees Celsius uniformly, so that the biomass will be, again, the, it is another way to remove the remaining moisture content. So we can remove the low moisture content which was available at the pelletization process, so we can also remove that. So that high calorific value of biomass can be available. If we discuss about the biomass gasification process, so biomass gasification process, after obtaining the pre-treatment, the biomass from the pre-treatment method, that is cylindrical sized pellets, these cylindrical sized pellets can be fed into the biogasifier for obtaining producer gas through a sequence of thermochemical reaction. So how thermochemical reaction is performed here? Here the biogasifier that can be of different types. Biogasifier can be downdraft, updraft, fluidized based bed. There are different type of biogasifiers, but we have to look into this important figure is that the direction where producer gas is flowing. Producer gas is the main output of this biogasifier. It is the gas which is the main output of this gasifier. The if the gas emits from the bottom, it is also known as downdraft, because producer gas is available at the bottom, so it is also known as downdraft. If producer gas would have had available at the top, it will be known as top draft. And again, if the producer gas is available at the between at the mid of the gasifier, it is known as cross draft. Now, what are the main steps of this gasification process? Drying zone, pyrolysis, oxidation, and reduction. Now, whenever these pellets of a particular cylindrical size is fed into the gasifier, the beginning stage is drying, so that in the drying process, the remaining portion of the moisture will be removed, so that energy container can be further improved. Now there is a stage that is pyrolysis, because in this stage oxygen is not present. Oxygen will be present here at the this stage, the third stage. So in the pyrolysis stage, since oxygen is not present, so in absence of oxygen, reactions will take place. So in this region, carbon monoxide, H2 hydrogen, or will be generated. This is nothing but the syngas. It is also known as syngas. And in the combustion zone where oxygen is present, carbon dioxide will be developed. That is, exothermic reaction will take place in the combustion region. And from the combustion region, the reaction, there will be a producer gas that will be emitted. We have to apply a pressure so that the producer gas will be taken out from the bottom of the gasifier. Hence, it is known as downdraft gasifier. And below the oxidation region, there is a reduction region. So in the reduction region, we will obtain the carbon. It is reduction. The oxygen will be emitted out from the CO2. So in the reduction zone, we will get some tar type of particle which we collected at the bottom. Okay, which is also known as grate. The bottom portion is also known as grate, which can be used to rotate the bottom portion of the gasifier so that proper heating will take place. Now at the bottom, there will be ash content or tar that will be accumulated. This is not useful for the gasification process. Then that can be taken out. Now, as we had discussed about the biogasifier, this is a biogasifier based generating system. What will happen? The producer gas that will be taken out can be, here some dust particle will also be there, some different type of gases will also be there. There is a cyclone separator. In a cyclone separator, some particular type of dust of certain microns can be removed from the producer gas. And again, there is a gas scrubber. So scrubber we had discussed, scrubber is a type of solution, liquid solution. And whenever the gas is passed through the liquid solution, the unwanted gas will be trapped and can be, and the remaining portion, that is the refined producer gas, can be used for further stages. Then there is a sawdust filter, so it will remove the sawdust, which is unnecessary in the producer gas, that can be removed here. Then there is a safety filter, and finally, the producer gas can be used for electricity supply. Now, if we talk about another important point, that is waste to energy, this is a big diagram, so we can look this clearly. The waste which is accumulated in a village, or it can be in a town, that accumulated waste, which is nothing but the trash, can be used as a fuel for generating power. Now, how it can be used for generating power? The burning fuel heats water into steam that drives a turbine to create electricity. This is the basic process. Any thermal process use this process, that is burning of fuel. Water will be there, and that water takes up the heat, that is, it can be converted in, it will be converted into steam, and that steam will rotate the turbine for electricity. This is the basic process. Now, what is the advantage? Advantage is that around 90% of the landfill, the accumulated bio waste, which is very hazardous if we keep this at open, if 90% of the available waste can be used in the waste to energy process, so only 10% of waste will be available that can be unutilizable. This 90% of landfill can be used as a waste to energy plant, and the CO2 emissions can also be reduced. Now, firstly, how to use this plant? Firstly, we have to segregate between recyclable, reusable, and usable biomass. So we have to separate the glass or plastic, polythene. We have to separate this with biomass, kitchen waste, like of thing. Some things, some will be reusable, some we have to reduce it, and some we have to reuse it. Basically the waste, which is kitchen waste or the biodegradable waste, will be can be fed into the pit, and crane will take this bio. If you have any questions, you can also ask in between. Okay, otherwise we can carry on. So there is a truck which is shown here, which will collect the garbages. Basically, biodegradable garbages will be filled into the pit. There is a large crane which is shown here. This large crane will pick this unwanted, the biodegradable substance, and it will be fed into this grate. Grate is basically the place where heating will take place. Thermochemical reaction will take place. So a chunk will be fed into this grate, and this biomass will be converted into heat within presence of oxygen. So combustion will take place. This combustible gas can be, there will be a heat exchanger, and the water which is available here in the pipes can take the heat and convert into steam, so that it can be used for electricity. Yes, okay. So there will also be a cooler which will change the temperature of the liquid from a certain value to a cool level temperature, that will be useful. There will be recycling of the water that will be taking place. Now we can also reduce the amount of CO2 which is directly burned from this combustion process directly into environment, can be controlled. Now from this we can see that there is a monitoring place, a person which is monitoring this whole event. So monitoring, basically we have to look into the amount of biomass which is available here, what is the time to perform the combustion process, how much amount of ash content which is not usable, that we have to look into it. So we have to monitor how this whole process is being operated. Yes, all right. So after discussion about all these important applications and utilization of these different bioresources, let us talk about a case study which was performed by me during my research. So in that case study, we will talk about the biomass assessment and its power generation. So we can look into this map of Uttarakhand. And in Uttarakhand, there is a district that is Almora. And in Almora, there are 7 villages which are shown here, which is under Dhola Devi block. Now my work was to design an integrated system. So in that, we can talk about these are the different villages, Nalpar, Seli. These are the villages, number of household, total population, their location, latitude, longitude, and elevation. So important point to be noted down, around 2,500 people are living here. So in terms of biogas potential and biomass potential that we will discuss, if we talk about the biogas potential first. So how to estimate the biogas potential in this case? There are villagers, and villagers are taking care of buffaloes, cows, mule, etc. for different purposes. So from these, we can collect the dung available, the dung which is available there, we can collect them. And this dung can be used to supply into anaerobic digester. And this anaerobic digester will supply the cooking gas, which is to be supplied to the villagers, and can also be used for electricity. Now the basic important points or features are that around 1300 cows are there, buffaloes are there, goats, and some mules are also there. So there are around 4000 cattle which are available there. If we talk about this cattle population, cows, buffaloes, goats, and these are the villages, the total is around 4123 that we had discussed. Now, how to estimate the dung available in terms of biogas? So for that, we can say the dung available, total number of cattle, dung available, that is kg per cattle per day. For particular cattle, nearly approximately how much cattle dung will be available, that is in kg per day. So we can say if 1300 cows are there, so what will be the total amount of dung available per day? It will be 1398 into 11. Now let us, around 75% of this available dung, this dung can be used, means 25% cannot be available. So let us take an efficiency around 75% availability. So 0.75% means 75%, we can get around 20,000 kgs of cattle dung. Now, if we talk about the biogas conversion, so for cows, for buffaloes, for goats, there are different conversion into meter cubes. So the amount of kg which is available there, and this is the conversion value, meter cube. So when we product this amount of cattle dung which is available, with the biogas yield, we can get it into, convert it into meter cube per day. Around 849 meter cube per day of biogas can be collected here. Now, for yearly basis also, we can estimate it in this fashion. We can directly multiply the 365 or 366, we can get the biogas available in a year. Now, if we talk about the first portion, that is the cooking portion, cooking demand. We had discussed around 2,500 people are living there. So in some literature, we can find out what is the amount of gas, biogas that will be needed for cooking purposes. For a particular person, it can be around 0.24, 0.25. Which was considered in my case, it can vary around 0.25 to 0.5 meter cube per day of biogas, which is needed for cooking for a particular individual. It can vary. Now, if we consider this value 0.25, if we multiply it with 2,500 people, that around 600.48 meter cube per day of biogas is required. Now, what is the biogas available per day? It was around 849.3 meter cube per day. So, if we reduce 600.48 meter cube per day, this amount of remaining amount of energy can be used for power generation. Now, let us discuss about the mathematical model of biogas generator. We had discussed about biogas generator in the previous slides. Through anaerobic digestion, and anaerobic digestion can be means combined heat and power plant will be there for that. So let us focus our attention into mathematical model of biogas generator. If we talk about the biogas generator, we can look into this equation, that is P power of biogas generator. T is the particular hour. Here Tg into CVBM into efficiency of BGG divided by 860 into T. So here what is happening? Tg is basically the meter cube per day available biogas, which is per day 248.28 meter cube per day is available. So what is Tg? Tg is this quantity only. Cv is the calorific value. So what is the calorific value? It is the amount of energy which is liberated when 1 kg of that substance is heated. It is given in joules. Okay, joules per kg. So in some cases we can also find it as joules per meter cube. If the calorific value is available in terms of, because it is biomass, biogas. So biogas is given as in meter cubes. So meter cube of 1 meter cube of biogas, how much calorific value will be there? It will be given as CVBM. If we multiply it with Tg, we will get the calorific value with Tg. And if we multiply with the efficiency of BGG, that is the overall plant, the anaerobic digester, the digester process, the CHP, and biogas generator, the efficiency will be very low, around 27%. So what is 860? It is the one by, if we multiply this overall value with 1 by 860, we can convert this calorific value from joules to, we can convert it from joules to kilowatt. That is the conversion value, 1 by 860. And why we are multiplying it with T? Because in the upper portion, we can say it is written as meter cube per day. Here, meter cube is being cancelled out. There will be joules per day will be there. So how to, because 1 hour is considered to be one unit. Hence, this biogas generator is operated for 9 hours. We had considered it to be operated for 9 hours. So we have to divide it with, multiply with 860 with 9 hours. So finally, we will get the power output. And this power output, when multiplied with T, that is 9 hours, we can get the overall energy output. Now, according to the available biogas, that is available dung availability, we can place different generators, but the overall power that was calculated in this case is around 35 kilowatt. Around 3 generators of 10 kilowatt each was placed in the these 3 villages, Dunar, Nauga and Tapri. Around 5 kilowatt of this generator was applied in the Nalpar village. Similarly, if we talk about the biomass potential, so in the biomass potential, we can see there are divided into 2 types, forest foliage and crop residue. Firstly, we will discuss about forest foliage. This is a hilly area, large number of forests are there, different type of forests are there, means forest comprising of different trees. So some of the trees which are basically found here are cheer, devdar and katua are the major trees which are available here. The total forest area is around 371.34 hectares. Now, from the convention, we can find out around 160 kg of forest foliage. It can vary. But in this case, around 160 kg of forest foliage, that is the tree bark or the branches which are broken. So we can collect this amount, these different type of barks and branches and in 1 hectare around 160 kg of biomass is available. 60% we can collect. We can collect 50%, 40% or 70%. You can consider according to your area. Of this 160 kg per hectare, how much amount of biomass that can be collected? Now, these are the different villages. Their area, forest area, around 371 hectares of forest area. Now, as we had discussed, around 160 kg per hectare was available as the biomass there. Now, if we multiply this with 28 hectares, we can get the amount, that is kg per year. Hectare will be cancelled out. And finally, we can apply 60% collection. Then it can further reduce to 35,648 kg per year. That is the available biomass from forest foliage. Or we can say simply as 35.6 tons. Now, we can look into a formula, that is AFJ into FPR into efficiency, NC. What is AF? AF is the available forest foliage that we had discussed. This is the 35,648, that is kg per year, that is available biomass. That is given here as AF. AF is nothing but the biomass forest foliage depends on the area under forest. Now, if we multiply it foliage production factor, now actually this is the available biomass that was available. When we multiplied foliage production factor, that is 160 in that case, we had discussed about 160 is the total foliage per hectare. So, and efficiency, NC is the efficiency of the forest residue, around 60%. So, this is the actual forest foliage collected that we had discussed in the previous slide, around 35,000. This can be calculated using this formula only. Now, again, if we talk about the crop residue, there are basically the seasons are divided into basically two different seasons. First is Rabi season and Kharif season. In Rabi season, the crops basically which are available here are matar, chana and soybean, which are grown here. And in case of, and also wheat. Wheat is the primary crop in case of Rabi season. Madua is a major crop during Kharif season in this area. Rice, mustard and masoor are also produced here. The total crop production area is 73.19 hectares. Now, if we discuss this biomass crop potential, the biomass crop collected from the forest foliage and crop residue that we will discuss, collectively we will discuss, let us focus our attention into the crop residue part. Now, these are the villages, these are the total area which is available, crop production area that we had discussed around 73 hectares. Now, if we discuss about the Rabi crop, these are the different type of Rabi crops. Now, major portion is utilized by the wheat, around 48%. So, 10.13, the 48% of 10.13 is 4.86. Similarly, for matar, chana and soybean, we can calculate. Similarly, in case of kharif also, around madua is around 44%. So, we can calculate like this. There will be a term that is, so we will get a total hectares in total hectares, what is the available bio crop residue that is collected? It is basically the crop, overall crop that is calculated. Now, productivity of grains. For different grains, we can find out what is the total productivity. Kg per hectare means in a hectare of a land, how much kg of wheat can be grown? So it can be different for different crops. 1097 for wheat, butter for is around 659. It is like that. Then there is a grain productivity and total biomass available. So how this can be calculated? Now hectares we can calculate. This is the total hectares. For wheat, matar, we can calculate. When we multiply it with kg per hectare, that is productivity of grain, we will get the overall grain productivity in kg. Now, overall grain cannot be used directly. Some portion is used for our food purposes, for crop, some portion of the crop is used for food. The remaining portion is residue. So crop is a bigger term and residue is a smaller term. The remaining portion is our food. So this is an important term that is coming out into the picture, that is crop residue ratio. We have the total amount of crop, overall crop consisting of food as well as residue part is around 38,000. But we have to differentiate the residue with the crop, with the food portion. So how we can separate it? So we have to take this crop residue ratio, which is nothing but the residue to the overall crop. What is the residue yield? It is kg per hectare to the overall crop yield in kg per hectare. So residue is slightly smaller than the crop, or it is smaller than the crop, overall crop. Its value will be slightly lesser than the one. So it can be, for a particular crop, we can have different type of CRR value, crop residue ratio values. Now the total biomass crop residue depends on the available area of crop production. That is area that we had discussed, hectares, total hectares of different crops. Crop produced per hectare, that is per hectare, if we multiply it, then we will get overall crop, that is in kg. If we multiply this with the crop residue ratio, because crop residue ratio is the residue per crop into total crop in kg, we can say the crop yield and the crop production will be cancelled out somewhat. So we'll get the residue yield with the percentage. So and efficiency of the biomass crop residue available, that we had discussed. For that we had considered around 75% in my case. So 75% of the available biomass can be collected. So we can similarly we can get the biomass potential of crop per year in case of crop residue and in case of forest foliage. So it was around 35 ton of forest foliage that was collected, 91 ton of crop residue that was collected. The overall biomass that was collected around 127 ton. This is the overall summary of that we had discussed. Now, if we talk about the biomass gasifier, this biomass gasifier can be converted into energy. So we can say power of BMG can be multiplied. Similarly, TB, it is the total tons or kg of the biomass available. When the kg of biomass available will be multiplied with the joules per kg, that is the calorific value of the biomass, into 1000. Because if we talk about tons, then we have to multiply it with 1000. If it is in kg, we need not have to multiply with 1000. Into efficiency of BMG, that is around 21%, biomass gasifier efficiency around 21%. Since it is yearly collected, so we have to divide it with 365 into total number of hours of operation in a day into 860. Then finally, we will get the total energy output when we multiply power with total number of hours. Basically, two gasifiers are present in this case, around 15 kilowatt. One each will be implemented in Naugaon and Seli villages. This was the operation, how the biogas and biomass gasifiers or biogas generator can be operated in different hours of operation. We can operate these different generating system according to our, this is another advantage. We can operate these bio generators at different time intervals. This is another important advantage. So from these, some conclusions can be drawn out, that is bioenergy and its applications are immense, that we have looked into. Their applications are immense. So another important point that we can focus into our attention, that is current bioenergy research around the globe should direct us towards reduced production cost. So we have to look into it, that how production cost can be reduced. The energy, that is bioenergy, which is available at the output side, how the cost of this availability of bioenergy can be reduced with better efficiency. We can see that efficiency is very low because large number of conversion devices are there. So cost effectiveness is a very important problem that we have to address here of biofuels. But the advantage is that the biomass in a large is a large source of energy in this 21st century, which can play a vital role in impacting in a better way in rural agricultural and forestry development. So thank you. These are the references that were included, and thank you for listening to me in a pleasant way. Thank you all. So with this, yes, you can. You have any questions? You can ask. Yes. Please.
Sir, namaskar.
Namaskar, sir.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
I'm Dr. Sardar Patil from Maharashtra.
Yes, sir.
Basically, I'm from geography background.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I have two questions. First one, does the modern toilet cleaners affect the generation of biogas quality? Did you get my question?
No, sir, please repeat it.
Yeah, modern toilet cleaners, because sometimes toilets are attached to the biogas plants in the household.
Yes, sir.
And we use some chemicals to clean the toilet.
Mm-hmm.
Does it will affect the quality of the gas generation or else?
Basically, it may have a bad impact, because yeah, whenever we are adding chemicals with means it can we are adding the chemicals because to make it clean.
Yeah.
But our purpose is to utilize the biomass or the dung which is available for better utility. Because whenever we are adding the chemical, its property will change.
Yeah.
Okay. So we need not have to change the property of the chemicals for better use of that in cooking purposes or electricity. Yes.
Okay, sir. Sir, I have another question. Does there is any standard correlation between the quantity of waste by the animals and the gas generation? Any standard?
Yes. There is a relation that I can show it to you on this slide. So as we had discussed that. For cows, buffaloes, goats, horses, and mules, there are different type of animals.
Okay.
But different type of animals have different means their dung output will also vary, because large animal can give large amount of dung.
Yeah.
As well as different animals have different selection of food products. Some cows can eat different grasses. Or different plant products, different leaves. Okay, because you can understand that different animals have different choices of their food habits. Okay, so dung output will also change. Means biogas will also change depending on how what type of food products that they are consuming. Yes, sir.
My question is direct. That is, suppose we use 1 kilo cow dung.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Or buffalo dung. How much biogas we can generate?
So we can see that for 1 kg of cattle dung. That is cow in this case, around 0.038 meter cube per kg of biogas that can be collected here. That is shown here, that biogas yield is around 0.038 meter cube per kg. So it is different for different animals.
Okay.
For goat, it is 0.07874. So yeah. it was taken from some reference. Sir.
Okay. Sir, I have one more query, not the question. Because in one slide you shown there that biogas has most of the combination of methane and carbon dioxide, and these gases are called greenhouse gases. Does it will have impact on climate change, global warming, etc.?
Yes, sir. You have asked a very good question. This slide, methane is around 50 to 65%. It is given.
From this slide,
it is very high percentage. We can use it for cooking purposes. So when we burn it directly, we can it will be harmful for us. But if we, as we have seen from this picture, there is a digester is there, and there will be a liquid digester biogas storage, and there are different scrubbers. We can see H2S scrubber, CO2 removal, CO2 capturing. When we use these different components along with these things, so we can reduce the amount of CH4 or CO2 which is emitted to the environment. So we have to add extra components here. Yes, sir.
Very nice explanation. But what is happening in most of the houses, they are not using another, that is extra methods for the, for filtering. They are directly using the biogas generated in the kitchen. At that time, it may be harmful.
It is also harmful. It is also creating foul smell. The smell is not good. So we have to add some extra components, such as H2S scrubber, which can remove the hydrogen sulfide, or water removal, CO2 removal, as well as CH4 removal. CH4 can be used in the fuel cell. Means we can use that hydrogen part in fuel cell.
Sir, does this filtering technology is available for common man and at lower cost?
So the problem is that the technology is upgrading. It has not reached to that limit, because when we are adding the extra components, it will help us to remove the greenhouse gases, but its cost will be very large.
Okay.
This we have to balance, because the number of plants is less. Yes, sir. So technology is evolving.
Okay, thank you, sir, for your nice interaction and nice presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I have one question. After H2S scrubber and CO2 capture, what is left out for burning? And if you reduce methane and all that, what is left out for burning?
Actually, you can see that there is a biomethane which is available here. After CO2 removal, there is a biomethane here. A methane that is harmful, but methane is actually the higher percentage. And methane is basically used for burning it, but we have to figure out how this biomethane can be used in a proper way, so that minimum amount of energy can be used for cooking purposes. So in this, that we can see biomethane is there. So biomethane is actually used for gas grid. Yes, we have to use the methane is major quantity, but we have to look out how this methane, biomethane, can be used in a proper way. Yes, sir?
So we use biomethane for burn as cooking gas, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, any other question you can ask?
No, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Sir, I'm little interested on the bioenergy, biofuel. So, according to the assessment of biofuel, we are following the European standard and ESTM, and in India, BIS. So each standard, they have a different parameters to be tested in order to make a quality biofuel. So according to India or BIS, which top five parameters can be considered as a good biofuel for industrial purposes, sir?
Actually, viscosity will be lesser. Okay.
Yeah.
The water content should be lesser. It should be of higher energy. Okay.
Yeah.
So again, we have to also look about the C10 or octane number in case of the petroleum product or ethanol, or in case of biodiesel. Also, we have to look into the calorific value of the fuel, and as well as we have to look into the stickiness. If the fuel is too sticky, it can shadow, means it can overlap the means the piston, as well as we can see the piston is there, and the if it will be too sticky, it can be absorbed in the periphery of the piston or the engine, we can say. So we have to select such type of fuel which will be less sticky, less viscosity, less viscous, high calorific value, less water content, and easily blendable. It can be easily blended to the different type of diesel or petroleum products, as well as reduce the efficiency of the means diesel as a fuel. Yes.
Okay. So thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
I'm Devajit Mishra. I want to know just one thing. Nowadays, some vehicles also use compressed biogas. Mm-hmm. So, what are the process for making compressed biogas?
So, for that, you have to increase the compression for that. Whatever gas we are available, that is available. Whenever we are increasing the compressor, we can increase the pressure of the gas, as well as the temperature will be increased. This can also be used to for electricity, as well as this can be also used to means as a fuel. Whenever we are increasing the pressure, we are reducing the means we are making the molecules near to each other, so that its pressure and temperature will increase. So we have to apply the more pressure in the gas which is emitted. We have to apply the compression techniques.
So all other thing means hydrogen sulfide or emission control, those are mainly affected on emission. They are remains on that gas.
No, we have to make the gas as pure as possible. Whenever we are using CNG, okay, like LPG cylinders, we have to make the gas as pure as possible so that efficiency will be higher. So during this process, different type of gases which are not required, that are being removed using different processes, like H2S removal, different type of gases will be removed which are unwanted.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Question, when ethanol is mixed with petrol, does it reduce the efficiency of the IC engine in automobile?
Yes, sir. Can you repeat the question, sir?
When ethanol is mixed with petrol as automotive fuel, does it reduce the efficiency of the IC engine in automobile?
Actually, the efficiency will not be hampered so much. That's why blending is taking place, because we cannot increase the blending above 10% like that. It will affect the efficiency slight a bit. The efficiency can be reduced, or it can be same, slightly it can reduce. But the main purpose is that the overall cost of the fuel will be reduced, because the petroleum cost is high. If we add 10% of ethanol, cost can be reduced, but efficiency has a slight impact. Very slight. Yes, sir.
And same case happens when biodiesel is mixed with the fossil fuel diesel.
Yes. Main main purpose of the discussion is that there are different type of biodiesel, which can get biodiesel from different vegetables or non-edible oils. Okay, different biodiesel have different properties. Some have some can mix with the diesel very easily. Some have to be converted into certain form so that it can be added. Their efficiency can vary. Similarly, in case of ethanol also, it can vary depending on the type of conversion process that we are following. Yes, is it okay?
So engine has to be modified according to the source of the ethanol production.
No, engine is not means in case of ethanol mixing, it is not required. We can use this engine also, the same engine also. That's why it is being blended.
Okay, thank you. And another question, when different kind of biomass is used for cooking, so the composition varies. So all the biomass, that means dung, animal dung, say from cow or say from horse, are mixed together to form the cooking gas. So the same burner can burn this mixed gas also?
Yes, sir. The basic part is that the gas which is available in meter cube per day that we had discussed, the available biogas composition will vary, but it will not vary too much. It will not vary too much. It will be nearly of the same form. From the cattle dung that is available, it will be nearly same biogas that will be available. Because the products that it consume will be the same agricultural products. Yes, sir. Because the goats and the cows, they eat the same biomass which is available in that area. They are consuming the same biomass. So the gas, biogas, which will be available, will be of the same characteristics.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Rukmi, sir, I am audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Okay, so here we will conclude the session. And thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us with your knowledge about the bioenergy and biogas. The lecture you delivered was full of knowledge, and it gave us the deep insight into the topic and also revealed some interesting facts about the bioenergy and the biogas. I am pretty sure that the precious knowledge that you give us will definitely help to the participants who want to work and who are working on the bioenergy. So once again, thank you very much, sir, for taking out the time for this expert talk from your busy schedule. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So here we will end our first session.